Today on Matters of Fact, the Philippine National Police wants the Interpol to issue a red notice to arrest a top communist leader for his alleged involvement in the massacre of former comrades in 1985. But Jose Maria Sison insists he's protected by the European Convention on Human Rights and the Geneva Refugee Convention. Mr. Sison, who founded the Communist Party of the Philippines, now joins us live via Skype from the Netherlands, where he has been in self-exile since the late 80s. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you, too, for having me.
Okay, of course, this is not the first time that Philippine authorities have tried to go after you, but this time there's another announcement coming from the Philippine National Police. They would ask the Interpol to issue a red notice so that you can be arrested. Now, what do you think of this? How likely will you be get arrested this time?
No, this is not the first time that the authorities in the Philippines have tried to make a charge against me. And it was in 2007 when there was a charge, and I won the case by 2009. But anyway, let me comment directly on this current false charge. It is politically motivated and fabricated. I must point out that in 1985, I was under maximum security detention, and I had no authority whatsoever in the Communist Party of the Philippines and the New People's Army. So we start with that fact. Now, I don't think that the warrant of arrest issued by the Manila court and the attempt to get what is called the red notice from the Interpol would be realized because, as I have pointed out, I am well protected by the Geneva Refugee Convention and by the European Convention on Human Rights, and that means to say that no international authority can override the fact that I am in the Netherlands and I'm within the jurisdiction of the Netherlands. I think my lawyers can easily debunk the false charge. And so they will, there's no way I can be extradited. There is no extradition treaty between the Netherlands and the Philippines. And then you have to take into account the two conventions that I have mentioned.
Okay. So, sir,
you see, I enjoy absolute protection from being deported from the Netherlands. Whether it is to the Philippines or to a third country, because I enjoy absolute protection from being put at risk.
When you say, sir, absolute protection, so what happens? So the Dutch police cannot arrest you, meaning physically seize you?
The Dutch government can contravene the law, specifically Article 3 of the European Convention on Human Rights, which says that I cannot be put at risk of being tortured or subjected to inhumane and degrading treatment. So if, let us say, I would be deported to the Philippines or extradited to the Philippines, I would be facing the same military that tortured me during the Marcos period. You see, the military organization continues to exist there. And of course, you know very well that Mr. Duterte is notorious in the whole European Union, as well as in the whole world, for being a tyrant and a mass murderer. As a matter of fact, there is a case against him before the International Criminal Court for extrajudicial killings. And these extrajudicial killings have been extended to the murder, mass murder of 30,000, to the killing of those considered as politically critical of him or opposed to him.
Okay.
You see, there is now a
Mr. Sison, just to clarify, because you mentioned Article 3 of the European Convention on Human Rights, you said that you're clearly protected under this convention, specifically Article 3. How exactly are you protected here? Because it mentions no one shall be subjected to torture or inhumane or degrading treatment or punishment. Because you mentioned that the same military apparatus or institution exists if you get arrested and extradited to the Philippines, assuming that extradition is in order. But does an arrest necessarily or automatically mean that you will be subjected to torture or inhumane and degrading treatment?
Yes, there is jurisprudence. You don't just rely on the exact words of Article 3. There is jurisprudence interpreting the article to protect a refugee from being exposed to repeated or another chance of being tortured by the same torturers that he had, the same military organization that kept me in solitary confinement for a long period of time in the Philippines.
So what do you think of this move by the Philippine National Police to request for a red notice against you? Do you think the Interpol will just ignore this, given the arguments that you mentioned, that you are absolutely protected?
I presume that it will be rejected or quietly the request, if any, will be made. It will be put aside quietly. Of course, the Interpol may probably give the courtesy, but I think it cannot decide to override the jurisdiction of the Dutch government over me. You see, that was tested in 2005. Foreign Affairs Secretary Alberto Romulo came over to the Netherlands without my knowledge. I would only come to know later. He was asking for my extradition. And so he was told that there is no extradition treaty. And he was advised, you better give us the best you can to show that he used the Dutch territory to commit a crime. So there was a false charge invented with testimonies collected by the Philippine government, and the Dutch police went to the Philippines in order to cooperate with the Philippine police, with the Philippine authorities. And they presented these testimonies, and all these were proven to be rubbish. Okay. But anyway, they went through the motion. But in this case, you know, the case is about 1985 incident, and that coincides with the time that I was in no position whatsoever to make orders to the CPP and NPA.
Now, let's clarify. Let's go back in history for those who are not familiar anymore with your case. How did you end up there in the Netherlands?
I entered the Netherlands as a lecturer. I was on a world university lecture tour. So I was on my European leg when I came over to the Netherlands on January 23, 1987. Then I intended to stay here for only a few months. But then my application for a visa to the U.S. The action on that application was being postponed every 6 months. So I stayed on and on until I was told that the decision of the U.S. State Department was no decision. They did not want to make any decision. Despite the fact that aside from an excellent academic program was arranged for me, and a program of lectures, I also cited the fact that I had to consult my American lawyers regarding my case against Marcos, and also to visit my mother, who was sick. So, but then the U.S. State Department refused to issue me the visa until Cory Aquino succumbed to the pressures of the military to cancel my Philippine passport, and the military filed a subversion case against me. So that was September 15, 1988.
So you got stuck
when
there.
My passport was canceled, I had to apply for political asylum in October 1988.
Okay. And the rest, of course, is history. Now, how do you respond to those who are challenging you to just go home and face the charges squarely?
I don't know that it's foolish for me to enter the trap of Duterte. I don't think I will get any fair trial in the Philippines. I would be subjected to torture, physical and psychological. And you see, the burden of proving that I will have due process in the Philippines belongs to a regime that is proving to be tyrannical more and more. And as a matter of fact, what's going on in the Philippines, there's a wide range of people from social activists to ordinary peasants and ordinary workers and peasants to bishops of religious organizations being red-tagged and being subjected to threats. Not just by threats by the troll armies of Duterte and the Marcoses, but actually threats from the military. And there have been exemplary killings already done against even priests, and some bishops have been given the most obvious kinds of threat. Duterte is trying to intimidate the whole nation so that he can impose fascist dictatorship on the Philippines, like what Marcos did
in the
early 1970s.
How do you see this latest arrest warrant or arrest order against you in the context of the stalled or abandoned peace negotiations, formal peace negotiations with the Duterte administration? Because one way of looking at this is that perhaps the government or the administration is trying to pushing you guys to back into a wall, to give you no other choice but to actually give into his terms and therefore resume formal peace negotiations. But what do you think is the relation of this arrest order in the context of the peace talks?
I do not think that Duterte is interested anymore in peace negotiations. He has been hell-bent on killing the peace negotiations, and he has actually put the negotiations in the kind of coffin that he has made. You see, we should be talking about Proclamation 360 and then 374, respectively, terminating the peace negotiations and designating the CBP and NPA as terrorists. And he has done a lot of repressive measures, adopted, he has made several legal issuances of his up to Executive Order executive order 70, which is meant to supposedly apply a military solution for the end of the revolutionary movement. And this involves using the military to command even the civilian agencies to participate in an anti-communist program, and which involves red tagging against not only communists, but even non-communists who are pointed to as suspects. So you are in the Philippines. The situation is if you are under suspicion as a drug addict or as a communist, you are not entitled to any due process. That's the situation. That's why Mr. Duterte himself is quite notorious Well, about the peace negotiations, I think this fabricated charge against me is an indication that he's closing every possibility of peace negotiations, because his interest lies in scapegoating the CPP and NPA, and so that he can adopt more repressive measures on his way to charter chains to formalize absolute powers and to impose fascist dictatorship on the Philippines.
But of course,
I would like to make a final point about this warrant of arrest. This is nothing. It has no effect. We can talk about it next month, and still they will not be able to get that Interpol red notice. And they will still not be able to go over the Dutch jurisdiction over my person.
Okay. Now, of course, talking about the peace negotiations, there's this perspective that the National Democratic Front of the Philippines, the New People's Army, are basically not that sincere when it comes to negotiating peace with the government, and that you're just trying to get as many benefits as possible under any administration. How do you respond to this? That your end game is not exactly to hammer out a peace negotiation.
The National Democratic Front of the Philippines has always demanded social reforms for the benefit of the Filipino people, especially land reform and national industrialization. And, you know, if those reforms are agreed upon, then that's a good basis for arriving at a relatively stable peace, and it can be the basis of a prolonged ceasefire. But you see, the military that is pro-US in the Philippines is always pressuring every president to terminate the peace negotiations. That has been the case. And the military officers from one layer to another always believe that they can rise in their position and amass wealth by keeping up the high budgetary appropriations for the military, and have the use of their power in order to engage in extortion and other illegal businesses. That's the military mindset, especially those who are the worst of them. There are good ones among them, most are of the bad type.
Okay, regarding your situation, because I remember when we had this conversation last year, especially during the first half of 2018, you were very, very optimistic that you might be able to return to the Philippines, even if not permanently yet, later last year, right? 2018, you were very hopeful that you'd be able to set foot in the Philippines again. But we know a lot of things happened between May and now. In 2018. Now, what's your mindset now? Are you still hopeful that at one point, perhaps later rather than sooner, you'd be able to go back in the Philippines still?
Oh, you're quite correct in saying that previously I was interested in returning to the Philippines. I was hoping that the peace negotiations would reach a certain level of success. It doesn't have to be finished completely, but a certain level of success, like finishing, mutual agreement and approval of a comprehensive agreement on social and economic reforms. I thought that if that would be worked out, then there is a basis for my returning to the Philippines. But then Duterte, every time there would be an incident, even if the military was the one conducting all-out war despite the peace negotiations, every time there was an incident in which the NPA hit any of the military units, Duterte makes a drama about well, he cries over the corpses of his men, but he goes too far. He does not present the matter to the Joint Monitoring Committee that has been created for the purpose of any side complaining against over any incident.
But of course,
right away to the press.
Let me ask something about that regarding the fact that you mentioned that the drama part, right? Because the other argument is this: why not just stop the hostilities to show sincerity in the peace negotiations? We know that you also have complaints about the military, but this talk and fight scenario that you seem to be open about, Duterte doesn't want it. So why don't you somehow go for this at that time to make sure that there would be more confidence-building measures?
The Filipino revolutionaries will not wade into any water where crocodiles like Mr. Duterte are operating. They would be finished in a short while. Like if he finished the lives of 30,000 drug addicts just to show he can kill. You give him an opportunity to finish you off, you get finished off. No? The only chance for peace negotiations would be for the Duterte to end his term, resign, or be removed from his office. Then the successor probably could be expected to negotiate with the NDF on a fair basis for the benefit of our people.
Now, with this arrest order against you, and of course with efforts to revive the anti-subversion law, what do you think of your chances, perhaps however slim, of returning to the Philippines after more than 30 years in self-exile?
Well, anti-subversion law would prevent me from returning to the Philippines, and that would be another nail in the coffin made by Duterte for the peace negotiations. But I must tell you that I'm a product of the anti-subversion law. We in the University of the Philippines were not at all frightened by the anti-subversion law, despite its death penalty. But we were challenged to fight for academic freedom and all other democratic rights when the anti-subversion law was being used by the Committee on Anti-Filipino Activities to suppress the publications being made by faculty members and students. We started to form study circles to fight the authorities. So thanks to the anti-subversion law, because of its provocations, thanks to the narrow-minded politicians who thought they could frighten the progressive and patriotic people in the university with the use of the anti-subversion law, they have indeed induced us to take the path of resistance in various forms eventually. Okay.
Now, finally, sir, what's your position now? Are you still willing, or somehow do you see the prospects of resuming peace talks happening under the Duterte administration? Do you still see that happening, or you'll just be willing to wait for the next administration to resume formal peace negotiations?
Well, you know, I respect religious people. They are serious peace advocates. I keep on praying that Mr. Duterte would be hit by the lightning as Paul or Saul was hit on his way to Damascus. If a miracle occurs that Mr. Duterte would like to have peace negotiations, I think the National Democratic Front of the Philippines would have to take his change of mind seriously. But I think it's too much now to expect Duterte will draw away from his determined scheme to become a fascist dictator. Anyway, if Duterte is not hit by lightning of any kind, then the peace negotiations would have to be expected from the next administration.
So, in short, it would take a miracle on Duterte for peace negotiations.
Yes, it would take
resume.
A miracle.
May That's
the
what
prayers
you're saying.
Of our religious friends take effect.
Okay. On that note, thank you very much, Mr. Jose Maria Sison, for joining us this morning. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, too.
Thank you for watching. Now, for more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button.